Hello everyone, I am Dr. Ishrat Sheikh from Abida Inamdar Senior College. I teach to the undergraduate students. Today I am going to discuss about cattle tick. It is a very serious ectoparasite of cattle all over the world. We will be covering following points in the lecture: introduction, marks of identification, life cycle, nature of damage, and control measures of cattle tick. So let us begin with the lecture. Today I am going to discuss about cattle tick, Rhipicephalus microplus. We will be covering the following points in today's session: first, introduction; marks of identification; life cycle; nature of damage; and control measures. So let us start with the introduction. Introduction. What are ticks? Ticks are arachnids. So they belong to class Arachnida of phylum Arthropoda. They have oval body and four pairs of legs. That means eight legs. And they are related to mites. Ticks are insidious pests. Now, what do you mean by insidious pest? Insidious pests are those pests which cause gradual harm, and then after some time they cause very serious effect. They are also obligatory parasite. Obligatory parasites are also called as holoparasites. Obligatory parasites are those parasites which need a host, which will need a host to complete its life cycle. Without host, it cannot complete its life cycle. Then it is an ectoparasite. Ectoparasite means it is found on the body. It is found on the body of animal. Then it is also sanguivorous. Sanguivorous means it feeds on blood. There are two families of ticks are there: Ixodidae and Ergasidae. Now, what is the difference between these two families? So if you see externally, so let us write here Ixodidae and here Ergaside. Okay, so Ixodidae are basically hard ticks and Ergaside are soft ticks. So if you see the difference, both have oval body. But the difference is that here in case of Ixodidae or hard tick, you will find there is presence of capitulum which is anterior. Okay, so anterior capitulum is there, therefore it is visible. Side there is pedipalp. And one more thing is there is presence of scutum or shield. In case of soft ticks, you cannot see the capitulum because capitulum is subterminal. So you cannot see it. And scutum absent. Also, here at the side, lateral side of scutum, there is presence of eyes. In case of Ergaside, eyes are absent. They are not there. Then body is hard. So hard covering is there. Sclerotized, hard integument. In case of soft ticks, the integument is soft. So here it is soft, leathery integument. Then this is the pedipalp. This is immovable. And in case of soft ticks, pedipalp is movable. Of course, you cannot see the capitulum and pedipalp because it is subterminal and from the dorsal side it is not visible. Other than these differences, there are some more differences. One is regarding the host. So, in case of Ixodidae or hard ticks, only one host is there. So, life cycle is completed in one host. Whereas in Ergaside, two or three hosts are needed to complete the life cycle. Another difference is regarding mating. Hard ticks mate only once in lifetime, but soft ticks, they mate many times. Feeding. Hard ticks, they feed continuously, but only once. And soft ticks, they feed discontinuously, many times. And they can survive without food for almost a year. One more difference is regarding egg laying. Hard ticks, after one feeding, they mate and lay eggs only once. In case of soft ticks, after every feed, mating and egg laying is there. So it is a number of time. Okay, so these are the differences between hard tick and soft tick. The next point in introduction is distribution. Ticks are originally from Asia. Later on, they were distributed to other continents because of trade. So, from Asia, they were transported to Madagascar. Madagascar is an island south of South Africa, and from there to the coastal areas, so east coast of Africa, then from there south coast, then progressively to the western coast of Africa, and from the west coast of Africa further on to Central America, South America, on the other side also they are even found in Australia. Next point is host complex. Basically, they are the ectoparasites of livestock, found mostly in cattle, deer, buffalo. They are also distributed in horses, donkey, goat, sheep, pigs, dogs, and some wild animals. The next point is marks of identification. So, marks of identification is those external characters because of which we can identify the organism. Let us draw the diagram. So this is the capitulum. These are the pedipalp. Then this is scutellum or the shield. Then the oval body. Four pairs of legs. Okay, so it is something like this. Okay, so these are the four legs. This is the hard sclerotized integument. Okay, so this is short, straight, capitulum. This is the immovable pedipalp. This is the oval to rectangular shield or scutum, and this is hard sclerotized integument. Usually the ticks measure 2 to 3 millimeter in length. Legs are cream color, pale cream color. Okay, so this is the external characters of hard tick, the one that we are studying, Rhipicephalus microplus or the cattle tick. Now, if you see from the ventral side, you will observe, if you see the ventral side of head, you will observe that there is presence of, this is the capitulum. And it continues till here. This is the capitulum. And on the side we have the pedipalp. Okay, so this is the pedipalp. Here there is presence of hypostome. So this is hypostome, and there is presence of teeth on the chelicera. So chelicera has teeth. Then tip of leg will show claws. So usually the legs are the usual insect leg, similar to it with very minor modifications. So we have here coxa, trochanter 1, trochanter 2. Then there is femur. Then this is the patella. Then tibia. And the last one is tarsus. It is long. And it is having at the tip, there is presence of pad, and adjoining the pad there are the claws. Okay, so this is the pad and these are the claws. Okay, so names if you want of legs, this is coxa, this is trochanter 1, trochanter 2, this is femur, patella, then tibia and tarsus. Claws present at the end of the tarsus is useful to attach to the host. Next point is life cycle. Life cycle of tick is very interesting. It is of 3 to 4 weeks. The life cycle of cattle tick is 3 to 4 weeks. Therefore, even if one or two ticks are there, within the next few months, there will be thousands of ticks. And initially, we will feel that the tick is not causing any problem. But after a few months, it causes very severe damage to the cattle. So the usual stages are egg, then the next stage is larva. This stage is also called as seed tick. The next stage is nymph and last stage is adult. The engorged female. Engorged female means the female which had its blood meal and mating has also occurred. So such females or the engorged female, they leave the host. They leave the host, that is cattle, and fall on the ground. There they lay eggs in cluster. One batch of egg in cluster. In a batch, there are around 2000 eggs. So eggs are laid in cluster. And these eggs are laid in soil cracks, then crevices, under stone. The eggs then hatch and we get the larva or the seed tick. The larva or the seed tick has two stages. Initially, one is the non-parasitic stage. And the second is the parasitic stage. So, non-parasitic stage is as soon as the larvae emerges from the egg or as soon as the larvae hatches, then that larvae crawls up and moves on grass blades. There it waits for the host. So, as it is waiting for the host without any food, therefore it is non-parasitic stage. It gets blown by wind. And it helps it in getting a host. This non-parasitic stage of larva can survive without food for a number of months. In summer season, it can live without food for around 3 to 4 months. Whereas in cold season, it can live up to 6 months without food. But if it is for more time, then it will die. Now, as soon as the non-parasitic stage gets a host, that is cattle, it is now parasitic stage and it will start feeding. It will start feeding on the blood of the cattle. Usually the ticks attach to the soft parts of the body such as inside of thigh, abdomen, then ear, udder. So if you see the ear of cattle, the fold of the skin of the ear, here you will find ticks, heavy infestation of ticks at this folded place. Then in case of udder, you will find, because the udder is made up of soft tissue, you will find ticks inhabiting the udder also. So basically they attach to the soft parts where it is very easy to suck the blood and it is difficult for that animal to shake them off. So after having feed or blood meal, it will molt. And after molting, it will be converted to the nymph stage. The The main difference between larva, nymph and adult is, in case of larvae, legs are three pairs. Okay, in case of nymph, legs are four pairs, and in adult also legs are four pairs. There is color variation. Larvae are usually brownish to cream color. Nymph are having scutellum orange to cream color, and adults are having it brownish color. The nymph is also a parasitic stage. So, because it is also feeding on the blood of the cattle, therefore nymph is also parasitic stage, and after feeding it will mold and form the adult. Now adult will again show parasitic stage and non-parasitic stage. So first it will show the parasitic stage. So nymph is converted to adult after molting, and this adult will start feeding. So it is 2 to 3 millimeter in size. Both male and female will start feeding on the blood. So they will have their blood meal continuously for a number of days. Then they will mate. After mating, males die and females, they are now grown to almost 12 millimeter in size, the size of a marble, and these females are called as engorged females. These engorged females fall on the ground. They leave the host and fall on the ground. So this is a non-parasitic stage. So this is a non-parasitic stage because after falling on the ground, they are not feeding. So here in this stage, they are not feeding. The sole function of the engorged female is to lay eggs. So she will search for crevices, cracks, or place under the stone and lay eggs. One batch of egg. And then the adult will, or the adult engorged female will die. So again from the eggs, the seed larvae will form and the life cycle will continue. Now the fourth point is nature of damage. So the cattle ticks, they feed on blood. As a result, there is decrease in weight of the cattle. Even it will lead to anemia. Because of this, there will be less milk, less meat. When the ticks are feeding on the blood, it causes stress. It is called as biting stress. So the animal is in distress. It is not able to do anything. The next is the puncture on the skin. So because of the puncture on the skin, it will cause damage to the hide. So we know that from cattle skin, hide and then leather is made. So if there are holes in the skin, then the hide will get damaged. You will not get good leather. It also leads to open wounds, and these open wounds can cause infection. Then ticks are vector of a number of diseases. They cause babesiosis, also called as cattle fever. This is caused by a protozoan, Babesia bigemina, and also by Babesia bovis. In this case, the symptoms are high temperature, and red colored urine. Another disease caused is anaplasmosis. This is caused by bacteria which is transmitted by the cattle tick. The bacteria is Anaplasma marginale. Anaplasma marginale is the bacteria that causes anaplasmosis. Then it also transmits tick-borne fever, and this is agent of Lyme's disease in deer, in human beings. It is by the protozoan Bufilus annulatus. The treatment for tick fever has to be done immediately. Immediately, whether it is cattle or whether it is to some extent in human beings also, it has to be treated immediately. Immediately antibiotics have to be given. Otherwise, the case will become very severe. Now, the next point is control measures. So first method is the mechanical control. Here what is done? The ticks are hand picked. So manually the ticks are hand picked and they are killed immediately. The second is the chemical method. So different chemicals are used for controlling ticks. So we have organochlorides such as BHC and DDT, which are applied either separately or in combination. Then there are synthetic pyrethroids. So, of which one example is cypermethrin. So, this is quite effective. Either it can be given as a spray or a dip. So, what is done in a spray? So, it is directly sprayed on the body of the cattle. And in dip, a tank is constructed in which solution of the chemical is made and the cattle is allowed to bathe in it, or the cattle is given a dip in this solution. Then various organophosphates are also there. So, out of which I have selected one example, chloropyrifos. This is also quite effective. Then we can spray linden dust, then carbaryl, malathion. These are all effective at the rate of 1%. We can also spray 0.19% arsenic trioxide, 0.19% arsenic trioxide. Then various acaricides. What are acaricides? Acaricides are those chemicals which are used to kill acarians or ticks. So, acaricide impregnated ear tags. So, these ear tags are put on the ear of the cattle. Then various pheromonal devices are also available. Which can be used to collect the ticks and kill them. So in this way, we complete our discussion on ticks.